good to see this number assembled this evening for our Sunday night service, and we want to speak about choices tonight. When we think about if we're going to fear, as we've sung in this song, if we're going to not teach the Word of God when we come under persecution, it's a choice we make. And the Bible is helping us make the right choices. But a lot of times we see this in the context of families. And I want you to turn your Bibles to 1 Samuel, the second chapter. And in these first four chapters is where we will be camped tonight and looking at two families. And it's interesting how it is set forth in the Bible. A fact that why we would be focused on these families. You've got Samuel and his family. It's going to be highlighted. Then you have Eli and his family. And there's quite a distinction between them as far as the character of the people that made up the families. And what that's based upon what they did. And they come just one right after another. It's not like we're going to talk about Samuel. You're talking about Samuel and Eli at the same time. And you begin to wonder, is that on purpose? Well, we're going to look at it as if it is, because it's how it's unfolding in our Bibles. We know the first chapter is that here was polygamy being practiced, and Hannah and Peninnah are going to be two wives. Elkanah is the husband, and he cared about both of them. But Hannah had no children, and Peninnah would make her life miserable because of that. And she'd weep. She would not eat. And he cared about her. He'd give her double portions and so forth. And then we come at the end of that chapter, or verse 12, that she prays for a son. Eli is here, and he sees her moving her lips, and he thinks she's drunk. And she says in verse 15, "No, my Lord, I'm a woman of a sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but I poured out my soul before Jehovah." You can mouth with your lips and no one hears, and you're pouring out your soul in prayer. And we find that her prayer will be answered. And because she has a man of God, of Jehovah, she will call his name Samuel in verse 20. And so we see the family. Hannah goes up with her husband, and they go up. Every time the year rolls around, they offer their sacrifices. That's kind of a godly family. Verse 22, he says, "For this child I prayed, and Jehovah hath given me my petition, which I asked of him." She had made a vow that she would dedicate him to God's service as long as he lived. He would practice the Nazarite vow. He would drink no wine, no grapes. It's interesting, some of the versions you have is the fact that in these verses, you'll say, I lend him. And the point is that God had lended Samuel to her. And now she is dedicating Samuel to God for the rest of his life. Those are good things. We listen in chapter 2 about Hannah's prayer. Godly people. And she prays and thanks God from the standpoint that he's the horn, that he's indeed her strength. And he blesses people when they're broken down, and that is true. And so she was praising God for what she'd been blessed with. She fulfills her vows. And in verse 12, now the sons of Eli were base men. In verse 18, but Samuel ministered before Jehovah. You're going back and forth. Base men. And look at Samuel. He was being a child, girded with a linen ephod. And in verse 20, Jehovah gave the seed of this woman for petition which was asked to Jehovah. She went to her own house. She had five children after him. God blesses them. Then in verse 22, Eli was old and his boys were very bad. You go, Eli, Samuel. And you begin to realize there's some good things about Samuel. In fact, you'll never read anything bad about Samuel in the Bible. And his family, that Elkanah cared about her well-being. Hannah prays a prayer, gets a child, fulfills her vow, never backs off that. Samuel is there ministering. He continues in chapter 3 and verse 10. Jehovah stood and Samuel's going to have to break the news to Eli that indeed God's going to judge him. And he did not skip a word. He did not fall back on what he was supposed to do. In verse 18 of chapter 3, Samuel told him every whit and had nothing from him. And he said, "It is Jehovah, let him do what seemeth right, seemeth him to be good." That's Eli's attitude. Let God do what he's got to do. But Eli was saddened. And I just want you to see how God layered them. He could have talked about one and then talk about the other. But they go back and forth. You know, that's the way it is with our families. We got good families. We got families that don't make the right choices. We got godly families that choose, dedicate themselves to serve the Lord. They make sacrifices. They make sure they're going to put the God first. And there's others that I will put myself first. And I will do what I want to do. That's Eli's family. It's what I want to see here this evening is that when we think about life, it's just full of choices. Thought about entitlements, choices, and consequences. And I would think some would say, well, I don't have to have a consequence for every choice I make. Well, there'll be something that comes from that. But sometimes you don't make a choice and there will be consequences of not making a choice. So we better choose this day who we're going to serve. And it better be Jehovah. Because if we don't make choices, if we just kind of go along with our feelings, go along with the world around us, we're not going to have a good outcome. I see three things in the comparisons of these two families. And the choices is either I'm going to honor God or despise God. There's no in between. No in between. And that makes it easy for choices. I'm going to honor God. But I never would despise God. Well, what will you be doing if you don't honor God? Despise or honor? 1 Samuel 2 and verse 30. We're getting in the middle of what Eli's family had done, especially his two boys. And we'll see in verse 30, "Therefore Jehovah, the God of Israel, saith, I said indeed that thy house and the house of thy father should walk before me forever. But now Jehovah saith, be it far from me, for them that honor me will I honor, and they that despise me shall be lightly esteemed. Behold, the days come, I will cut thine arm off." Who is despising God? It's Eli, especially his two sons. And verse 29 says, "Wherefore keep ye at my sacrifice and my offering, which I have commanded in my habitation, and honorest thy sons above me." He's speaking to Eli. "You've done that above me to make yourselves fat with the chiefest of all the offerings of Israel, my people." Eli was high priest, his sons were priests, and they were to be serving the people. But either I'm going to be honoring God, or I'm going to be despising God. He's speaking to Eli, whose family's made that choice. Not Eli, but his sons. And Eli's being held responsible for that as a father. So let's see what is taking place. Because we're speaking about our worship. In verse 29, "You kick at my sacrifice." How is that happening? Well, let's pick up that segment in chapter 2, in between Hannah's prayer and Samuel's dedication of serving God. And the family's dedication of that. He says, "Eli's sons were base men. They were wicked men, unprofitable men. They knew not Jehovah." They were priests and did not know Jehovah. Just want to pause there. Can you see why there's going to be honor or despise? You know who's going to be able to despise? They kick at the sacrifice? Is those that don't know God. These are priests. And you say, "I know God. I know Jehovah." You don't know him. You might know about him, but you're not in the right relationship with him if you're not honoring him. We'll find some area where you're really despising God. You're not honoring his sacrifices. that are supposed to be made, and this is what they do. And so it already had become a custom. And the custom of the priest with the people was that when any man offered sacrifice, the priest servant came while the flesh was boiling, and a flesh hook of three teeth in his hand, and he struck it in the pan or kettle or cauldron or pot, and all that the flesh hook brought up, the priest took therewith. And so they did in Shiloh and all Israelites when they came together. Before they burnt the fat, the priest servant came and said to the man that sacrificed, "Give flesh to roast for the priest, for I'll not have this boiled flesh." In Leviticus, the 7th chapter, when the sacrifices were being authorized by God, and we had like the peace offerings. In Leviticus, the 7th chapter, and verses 28 following, you'll find that here was the chief meat that indeed the priest would get. They would get the breast and the shoulder. Pretty good. God gets the fat. But they would have a heave offering. And the person giving the sacrifice, offering a sacrifice, wanted to raise that and would give that to the priest for a heave offering. And he says, verse 5, "The fat with the breast shall be bring, that the breast may be weighed for a wave offering before Jehovah. And the priest shall burn the fat upon the altar, but the breast shall be Aaron's and his sons. And the right thigh," my Bible, it's the shoulder part of the animal, "shall he give unto the priest for a heave offering. And among the sons of Aaron that offer the blood of the peace offerings to the fat, they shall have a right shoulder for a portion. For the wave breast and the heave thigh have I taken of the children of Israel out of the sacrifices for their peace offerings." Before they could even have the wave offering, the hook was coming in, and we don't want sodden meat. While it's boiling and had not been completed, they're getting what they want. And they're not following what God says to be done. And they're covetous, and they're not following the order in which it has. These people, God gets the fat. This needs to be done first. And they had already made it a custom. This is how we do church here. This is how we do our worship. "In vain do you worship me, teaching the doctrines, the precepts of men." They had their own way. They were kicking at the sacrifice. And they were despising God in front of all of the people. And our worship needs to be according to the commandments of God, not the way we might want to do that. And I wouldn't think, well, we came to worship today, but did you despise God? Or did you honor God? If we follow the precepts of men, we're not honoring Him. In vain do we worship Him. Secondly, their personal conduct. Back to 1 Samuel 2 and verse 22. Eli is old, and he heard about what his sons are doing. And he heard that all of his sons did this, how they lay with the women that did service at the door of the tent of meeting. Fornication was taking place at the door of the meeting of God's house. Who's involved with that? Religious people. Priests. Teachers of the law. Trying to be good and influence and teach the people. That was indeed their conduct. God's word says a lot about fornication. And the sexual, full of sexual desires outside the holy state of matrimony between two people have a right to one another. But I think Thessalonians is so instructive to young people that are growing up and will have to deal with these passions as we grow up and have them in our lives. But in 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 1 through 4, he indeed is beseeching the brethren to walk the way they should walk as a Christian. And that they were doing that pleasing God, so they're honoring God. And that I want you to bow more and more. And in this context, he says in verse 2, "For know that what we charge you through the Lord, this the will of God, even your sanctification, that you abstain from fornication." And he emphasizes this, that each one of you know how to possess himself of his own vessel in sanctification and honor, being set apart pure sexually, and which is an honorable thing to do. And it's, I'm to control my own vessel. There's my body with all of its passions and desires. It is to be sanctified. And he says, not like the passion of the Gentiles who know not God, that no man transgress and wrong his brother in the matter, because the Lord is an avenger of all these things, as he also forewarned you and testified. That may give us an indication what kind of fornication is happening in Thessalonica. Corinth, very much idolatry with the priest. In this sexual sin, he wronged his brother. He had sex with another person's wife. And God's going to take care of that in judgment. Take care and control your own vessel. Yes, we need to understand, I'm not going to blow on anybody else. Sexually, that's just a wife. But he had taken someone's wife because that's how he wronged his brother. And you get to the point that you will wrong a brother to satisfy your passions. That shows you how strong our desires are if we don't choose to honor God. We'll be despising him. And the brother just collateral damage, because I'm going to get what I need for satisfying me. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 18 that you flee fornication. We tell our young people, flee it, don't rationalize with it. And that's very good advice, very strong. And God says to do that. But do you add the three things that come next? Well, we're instructing our young teenagers, flee fornication. Number one, why? Because every sin that a man doeth is without the body, but he that committeth fornication sins against his own body. In the sense that he uses the body. That's one sin, you're using the body as an instrument for the sin. And we need to understand your body, secondly, is a temple of the Holy Spirit. Keep it holy. Holy Spirit, holy. And he dwells in us through his word, but that's instructive too. And thirdly, you are bought with a price, as Christians are, and we're raising our children to be Christians. You are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body, that young vessel that you have. Whatever age you are, we're here to glorify God in our body. We are a place where God's word abides, and the Holy Spirit dwells within us through that word. We're therefore to keep it holy. And I don't want to sin against my body. God created it to be used to his glory. Now the one is saying, as the Bible does talk about, you want to make a man jealous? Then you have an affair with his wife, and it's going to be rough on you. And I can read that, but he didn't say anything here about getting caught, about being embarrassed. We're going to honor God, or we're going to despise him. And it's not only comes out in our worship, which these boys of Eli didn't do correctly, and their personal conduct is abhorring. And you say, especially for our priests. Yeah. And here are the women that are serving at the door, making sure all the sacrifices done right and serving the people, and they're having sex together. And where's Eli? Well, he's kind of complaining about it, but Samuel and his family, we pick up in chapter in verses 18 through 21, we see that his family is being dedicated to God while these things are happening. That's why it just kind of stands out as something to observe. But in 1 Samuel, the second chapter, verses 18 through 21, Samuel ministered to Jehovah, being a child girded with a linen ephod. She made him a little robe. Every year she would come and dedicate that to him. They were blessed with 5 children, as we mentioned a while ago. She conceived and bare 3 sons and 2 daughters. And the child Samuel grew before Jehovah. Things are going good in that family. But you just read in verse 22 what Eli was having to deal with his 2 sons. And they're making choices how they're living their lives. I'll be driven by my desires, and I will fulfill my vows, even when it means I dedicate my son to God for his entire life. In chapter 3 and verse 11, mentioned the difficult thing that he was going to have to tell Eli, because God calls his name 3 times, and he goes to Eli. Eli says, go lie down. And the 4th time, he told God, God told him what he's going to have to say. Verse 15, Samuel lay until the morning and opened the doors of the house of Jehovah, and Samuel feared to show Eli the vision. Then Eli called Samuel and said, Samuel, my son, he said, here am I. He said, what is this thing that Jehovah has spoken unto thee? I pray thee, hide it not from me. God do so to thee, and more so if thou hide anything from me. Of all the things that he spake unto thee. And Samuel told him every whit. Was that an easy thing for Samuel to do, to make that choice to go ahead and do what he's supposed to do? No. It hurt him. He didn't want to show the vision. He feared to do that. But you make a choice, I'm going to serve God, and you may be afraid and fearful of the consequences, but you do that because you made a choice, I'm going to honor God. Because if I don't fulfill what God told me to do. And he picked a time to speak to him when, in verse 2 of chapter 2, when Eli was laid down in his place, now his eyes had begun to wax dim, so he could not see, and the lamp of God was not yet gone out, and Samuel was laid down to sleep in the temple of Jehovah, where the ark of God was, that Jehovah called Samuel, said, and he said, here am I. Look at when God comes. It's not a real opportune time. We're kind of settling down. And he calls him, and he calls him, and he calls him. And Eli said, I didn't call you. 4 times Jehovah tells him, and it's not an easy thing to do. God doesn't come at real easy times for you to obey him and for you to have the glory, to glorify him. That's going to come regardless of circumstances. It's going to come because I'm going to honor God regardless of what we're having to face. Samuel and his family went through the difficult time of giving up a son, dedicating him to God, doing things that are difficult. And Eli and his family's taking the easy route. I'll just fulfill my lust. I don't care what that looks like to people. I will get the sacrifices that I want. I'll get the meat that I want. I will do it the way I want to do that. And if you want to wait the order and let God have his part, I'll take it from you. That's what orders were, from the servant to the people, from these 2 men. So we begin to see that era of worship, our personal conduct, especially the sexual relationship and the family relationship. And we begin to realize marriage is something that's very important. Because when you think about your choice, when you think about who you're going to marry, you're going to marry that person for life. So we pick up with Phinehas. He's with his brother. They're doing those sins. And you need to say, this was what their character was. We've already seen their base men. Worthless men. They didn't know God. They were greedy. They were selfish. And they were fornicators. That's what they were. And you begin to realize, well, why would you want to be married to that person? Well, one was. One lady was. In 1 Samuel, the 4th chapter, verse 19, Eli has a daughter-in-law, and his daughter-in-law, Phinehas' wife, happened to be with child, and he's having sex with women. They're not his wife. What would you expect? He's not even honoring the marriage relationship. And that's something that's indeed very important to God. So when you think about the one you're going to marry, you need to think from God's word that those who don't know God, in 2 Thessalonians 1:8, judgment is going to be very difficult and harsh on them. Him that know not God and obey not the gospel will be everlasting destruction. Those who are factious against God and they want to do their own thing, Romans 2 and verse 8, and they rebel against God and not going to honor his truth, they're just going to honor their own way of life, judgment is coming upon them. In Romans 2 and verse 8, we see, but unto them that are factious and obey not the truth. Well, I'll just sit here. I just won't obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness. When we don't obey the truth, we will be obeying unrighteousness. Shall be wrath and indignation, tribulation, anguish upon every soul of man that worketh evil. Jew first and also the Greek. Factious. A factious man is just one, not one causing disagreement. A factious man is kind of like he's the center and everybody orbits around him. It's his ideas, the idea of focusing upon the person and not upon honoring God, not upon the glorifying God. It's, I'm going to glorify myself. And here are people that, because they're factious, they don't obey the truth. They obey their truth, as our day knows that very well. Don't know God. They don't care for the truth, how God wants us to do our worship. They're not honoring the marriage relationship. And Luke 3:14, they're extorting. And that's what the soldiers in John the Baptist's day were not to do if they show signs of fruits of repentance. But here's the character. When we choose to do actions, we form a character. Give in to your desires and not care about others, you'll have a character of being a base man and being worthless before God. Hebrews 13:4 says you're supposed to honor marriage. You think Phineas was doing that? Married, had a wife, and he's fornicating from the house of God. And there's your priest. That's why they're despising God when they do that. There's no middle ground. And we are either going to honor him or we're going to despise him. And we, in God, in our families, especially fathers, need to realize character matters. And you're marrying a character when you're marrying that person. And that needs to be very strong in our lives. We think about our choice. This is where Eli had failed. Oh, he was concerned. You just seen his attitude when he's told what's going to happen to him. God's going to make that done, and he's okay with God. It's not going to be pleasant for him. But one of the things we learn is that fathers are to discipline, not just complain about how things are going with their children. Because he did some complaining. He did not let this go without him saying how much he didn't like it. In 1 Samuel 3 and verse 13, here's the message that Samuel had to tell him. Why he's going through this is for I have told him that I will judge his house. God says, as he's speaking to Samuel, I will judge his house forever for the iniquity which he knew. Because his sons did bring curse upon themselves, personal responsibility. But Eli, you didn't restrain them. Now these boys weren't 5 and 6. They had fornication, practicing that, had a wife. What can I do when they get to that age? He could have kept them out of what they're doing as this priest. He could have stopped how they were misusing people as they would have their peace offerings brought to the priest. He could honor God's house. And we may get to the point that we might not be able to discipline like we did when they're younger, and we ply the rod of chastisement, and they get to the point where they're not. But we're going to have some influence. We're going to have some opportunities to realize that they're going to have to straighten up, especially if they're living under your roof and spending your money and having all the pleasantries that are around you that they've always had. You can stand up. So we're going to church. You're not going to practice this in our house. No, I'm not going to give you money for this or that. You could restrain. And Eli did not do that. Oh, his heart was broken. But he didn't restrain. In verse 23, why do you do such things? Verse 23. For I hear of your evil dealings from all the people. Nay, my son, it is no good report that I hear, making Jehovah's people to transgress. And you're involved in helping them transgress God. Especially the women that are serving there. And the sacrifices, the way they're being offered. God held him responsible for something he could do as a priest, and especially related to them serving as priests as well. What can we do? I mean, they're outside our home, and there's a lot of things that change when they get to be adults. But sometimes children are staying home, and we have them later on in their young years, past 20, 21. And we just give up and let them do what they want to do, complain about it. No. We can find ways to try to lead them and bring them to the place they need to be. But it's going to be your choice. That'll be difficult. But you're either going to honor God or you're going to despise him. And it was on them, the sons, what they did, it was upon them. But Eli said, you didn't. God said, you didn't restrain them. We think about the Ark of the Covenant. It becomes a very important matter with the Israelites. It was where, indeed, God's presence was. This is now in Shiloh. And between the cherubim and the Holy of Holy place, and indeed that's where God would meet. And his presence was there. What it became is that they could have the presence of God on the battlefield. And there came a time when that Ark of the Covenant was in Shiloh where it should, that the Philistines came and they kind of got the best of Israel. In chapter 4, 3 and 4, the people were coming to the camp, the elders of Israel, and said, wherefore hath Jehovah smitten us today before the Philistines? Let us fetch the Ark of the Covenant of Jehovah out of Shiloh and unto us, and we bring it, it says that he may come among us and save us out of the hand of our enemies. So let's go get the Ark of the Covenant. What it symbolized was that God is with us, and the people like the Philistines knew that. They feared God, who had defeated the Egyptians. They fear God. That indeed here was representing his presence. And that's exactly what they did. So in verse 5, and the Ark of the Covenant Jehovah came into the camp, and all Israel shouted with a great shout, so that the earth rang again. Earth is shaken, it's ringing. And when the Philistines heard the noise of the shout, said, what meaneth the noise of this great shout in the camp of Hebrews? They understood the Ark of Jehovah was coming to the camp, and the Philistines were afraid that God is coming to the camp. They knew what it meant. And they were afraid, for they knew what he had done. In fact, they used the term, these are the gods that smote the Egyptians. We're in trouble. I want to pause there. And right before we read in verse 5, verse 4 says, so the people sent to Shiloh, and they brought from this the Ark of the Covenant of Jehovah of Hosts, who sitteth above the cherubim, and the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were with the Ark of the Covenant of God. They're coming to the battlefield. Coming with the Ark of the Covenant. They are the priest. And you know what they really are. But here we go. And the Philistine leader said, you better act and quit yourself like men and fight. Because you don't want to be servants like they have been with the Egyptians. And when they did that, 30,000 footmen fell at their feet. They defeated God, God's people. And the Philistines fought, and Israel was smitten, and they fled every man to his tent, as we see in verse 10. And there was a very great slaughter, for there fell of Israel 30,000 footmen, and the ark of God was taken. And by the way, the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were slain. It represented something. And I just ask you, is your choice living holy, or is it just round symbols? This Bible represents God's Word. Do we read it to make us holy? To set us apart from a world that can contaminate our thinking? We keep our minds straight and we're going to follow that because we're going to honor God? Or does this become a symbol? And we become like the people. Well, I'm a Bible-thumping, gun-toting American. What's Bible-thumping means? I go to that Bible all the time. Here it is. Do you live by it? Is it something that guides you? Do you care about putting those 3 points about fornication maybe there and you're teaching of your boys and girls? Oh, I don't read that closely. You should. It's powerful things for a young family to have children grow up with that thought in mind. My body is going to be used to glorify God. God's word reminds me, I'm going to keep it holy like the tabernacle of old and the temple of old. I've been bought with a price. And I'm going to glorify God in my body. Those things you get from God's word, you don't get that from men thinking this is how you ought to handle fornication. And then it's not just a symbol that we rely on. It's a choice that we have to follow that. Is that what the Bible is to you? Just a symbol? It just represents God's word and it means nothing else to you? No. We want better than that in our lives. Let the men of God not be ashamed, handling aright the word of truth, 2 Timothy 2:15. James 1:21, there's some things I got to put away. Overflow to wickedness. So, and then receive with meekness the implanted word, not the Bible thumping, not just a symbol, symbolic use, that the word dwell in us. It saves us, by which we're saved. And it becomes real to us. What it had become to the Israelites for the Ark of the Covenant. And you got Phinehas, they're there, and you know it's just a symbol to them. And what happened that day? Things came to a kind of a point that you would think, I cannot believe that happened that day. What happened when the Benjaminite, in 1 Samuel 4:17 through 21, when he comes to bring the people the news of what had happened on the battlefield? Remember, the earth is ringing and excitement because the Ark of the Covenant has come. And you already know that Eli's two sons, they're dead. The Ark of the Covenant has been taken. And you begin to see how things unfold on this day. And you begin to realize, here's the news. Here's something to be alert to. The ark has been captured. There's presence of God. And now Philistines have it. Eli's sons are dead. Hophni and Phinehas were slain. Eli is saddened. He's 98 years old. He's fat. He's sitting on a stool. And when he heard the news that the Ark of the Covenant had been captured and his son's death, he fell over backwards and broke his neck. You thought, how did that happen? What a shame. Look what happened to that family. It's not over yet. Phineas's wife, premature birth of their son, or birth of their son, had a miscarriage. She's going to die at this moment. And she will. So he had a premature birth. She's dying. Eli's dead, her father-in-law. Her husband's dead. And she hears the news, and she sets forth a premature birth. And what does she say? Oh, the one there comfort her. He's strong. That's going to be a good thing. He's a son. And she said, all the glory. Verse 21, she named the child Ichabod. Is that when you name your children, those of you who are having babies, is that one on your list? I doubt it. But if it is, you might want to strike it, because the glory is departed from Israel. Because the Ark of the God was taken, and because her father-in-law and her husband are dead. And she said, the glory is departed from Israel, for the Ark of God is taken. The presence of God, she knew that. I lost my husband. But here is what he'd be Ichabod, because God's glory has left us. That's why they're getting all of this particular news, that indeed God's glory had left. And the thing I want you to think about as we close, there's a warning. Sometimes events come together, may not be as dramatic as this, but remember these first four chapters were there to appreciate. It's one side of the family, Eli's family, Samuel's family, choice is good, choice is bad. But if we think we can get by with having power, getting what we want, neglecting God, doing what we want to do, sometimes the events come together that shows the consequences of very bad choices. And God is going to bless Samuel, and things will continue. But what a sad moment for the Eli family. And how did she get married to him? She should have been looking at his character. And maybe it wasn't like that at first, but that said, you've changed. There wasn't any, seems like that's the way they're going to be. Eli is falling on his work of, don't complain about it, do something about it when you had the power to do so. They had a way of honoring God and the sacrifices and how they took them, but they had gone all past that. And the Ark of the Covenant was just a symbol. Because if they really believed God was with them, how could those two men be there with the Ark of the Covenant and living the lives that they live? And what happens is that God brings discipline on them. He brings the punishment upon them on Eli's house. And Eli dies hearing some very bad news. But that's the way bad choices end up. I hope it doesn't end up that way for you. And it is, I'm going to make some good choices. I'll kind of study my Bible. I may ask for advice from people who have been studying their Bible. But I want to make some right choices, the moves that I make and decisions I make. I'm just giving you either going to honor God or despise Him. So what honors God? And you'll find it right here. Don't let it just be a symbol sitting on your table or your bookshelf. Let it be a reality that says, I'm going to honor God by honoring His Word. And we're going to form our family. We're going to guide our family, especially husbands and fathers, guide them in the way that that they should go. Take that leadership role, but do so with the Word of God. You'll never regret that. Making those kind of choices, you'll calm down as life unfolds. You realize, I'm happy I did that. You'll never regret it. And you'll be grounding young people in the Word of God to face this horrible, turned upside down, evil world that we have. But you know what? It's always been evil. And it always gets turned upside down. And the only thing that keeps you right side up is this. Follow it. You'll never regret that. You'll save your soul, and it'll save your children. This evening, if you're subject to the gospel invitation, by that I mean you're old enough to know I'm a sinner and realize that Christ is my Savior, and I need to be united with Him in baptism so I can become a child of God, we're here to assist you in that. Or if you need to make things right with God because you've fallen away, you're with a family who cares about you. So come, make things right as we stand and as we sing.